fifth shot. Man.
It is what it is. So yeah, C6, first inversion of C, of A minor 7. So not only can it be used for that, like there's, it can be used for a lot of things, but like its three obvious functions are use it as itself, use it for A minor 7, and use it for C7. This one that we don't think about as much, like, oh, it's a major chord. But it doesn't have a 7 there. So it's to say you can't use it, and since the 6 is the 13th, it's just making it, some you might call it a 13th chord, but the way it's voiced has the 6 in the lower octave normally, so we would think it was just a C6, but who's to say we couldn't do that? 13th's not an alteration by any means, it's just an extension, like that's the difference kind of between like extensions and alterations, is they're just colors.
So you're saying if you use that voicing for a C, like C7, dominant C7, but since there's not the minor 7 in that configuration,
It's completely fair game. And you know, like say like, you know, the Benz have got the 7 cover.
Yeah.
You know, like
I'm gonna say if you're playing with another chordless, which is so they're probably gonna play the 7.
Yeah, it can be kinda cool, you know, to mix that up. That's the fun part if you're really close with, you know, your with another like instrument, and then you really get to know each other and oh, he's gonna do this, so boom, and then you get complimentary voicings like stacked on top of each other and it's like, woo, that sounded cool. You know. So yeah, the same situation applies to all of the extensions, like the 9th or the 2nd or the 11th or the 4th, if they get to be included, that can be useful. So it could be used in these, like I said, in those three ways, or in more complicated ones if you really want to get into it, like, you know, like it can be used as an F chord, it can be used, you know, over and over again, like I've shown you earlier. Just it gets ridiculous. So you're moving past that. Yeah, like I said, since basically represents the root, it becomes optional yet encouraged to leave out the root of the chord, especially for a pianist, since the common voicings create a minor 9 dissonance. That's not always preferred. On the guitar, the root doesn't sound as bad. It just the way it's voiced, it's like underneath the 5th or you know above the 4th. So normally, so it's not always such a buggy note, but certain versions will totally sound like trash. I mean, they're wrong. Like it's, and if you can get rid of it, toss it. You know, but it's not the end of the world. But with the pianist, it's just like, would you get rid of it? Just it's gone. It's not there. It shouldn't be there. It doesn't sound right. But they're like it because they have the ability to voice anything however they want. They could simply be playing block or drop two, or drop three voicings and copying my voicings exactly. In which case, you know, the root, like I said, the root sounds fine there. So that would be a way for them to voice it, and you know that way. So yeah, hitting the root and other selected chord tones increase the possibilities of voicings, as well as introducing new concepts such as personal choices. This is my kind of like note to myself. But personal choices, like what do you like, what do they like, you know, what we were talking about earlier. Related chords, substitutions, extensions, passing chords, planning, reharmonization, tonicization. And when applying these tools, it's always considered important to consider the history of the tune and application. What is the style of the tune? What are common chords used during that time? How do they voice them on their instruments? Maybe what's their primary role in the ensemble? Do they interact a lot with the soloist? That's another question. And at what dynamic? A big one, right? People like tend to overlook. Like, yeah, you're comping, but could you turn your amp down, please? Like, we can hear you. We've got it. And we're saying how rapid or placid is the harmonic rhythm, for instance. So what, Donnelly? Completely opposite tunes. And I find like a Wildflower by Wayne Shorter, if you think about that, like, and then we have these like combination tunes where like we may have sections of very rapid movement and then this placid, very static harmonic movement. Now saying that about like the history of the tune, now just because we're playing All of Me does not mean that I need to play everything in like the most boring stock voicing ever because it's an old tune. But if I want that sound, you know, that would be the particular thing to do. If that's like the desired goal, I always think it's good to advise people that they have these choices. Just because it says C6 does not mean I need to play C6. For instance, like, this was my board exercise. Dr. White, I would go to the board, no, I'm just kidding, but it's like, for the first 8 bars of all of me, C6 and then E7, you know, 4 bars of each. Mm-hmm. So it's like, do I really want to play C6 for 4 bars and then play E7 for 4 bars? Or like, what else could we do? You know, like, what would be another combination? Maybe like C6 for 2 bars, C6-9 for 2 bars, E13 for 2 bars, and then E7 sharp 5 sharp 9 for 2 bars. Get a little nasty, stronger pull at the end. You know, that's just one way, and then thousands of combinations. You know, without even adding a substitution on that one, that's just a little alteration in extensions. Only one alteration in all extended tones. And you've already got a completely new thing. You know, you can be like C major 7, C 6, C major 9. C major 6-9. One new chord for every bar, then you can just be like E7, E9, E13, stack them up, and then E7 sharp 5. Nice voice leading, and you know, take the 6 down at the end. Boom! You're hardly changing anything, but you're creating this movement that can pull the song along in a new way, and inspire a lot of probably some of the soloists to maybe play off of that. If they're not already on the path to do so, it's like, you know, and it's that. Yeah, exactly. I mean, I feel all too much that I'm kind of making my soloist go with me more than I am letting him go by himself sometimes, because I had a fun rhythmic idea that I decided I was going to go with. And so it's something to work on, but I don't think that it's necessarily bad to have a good idea and help them out. But, oh, I got one for you. Play off that. You know, at the same time. So, choosing these appropriate desired sound for musical moments is a lifelong process, and naturally becomes more organic with experience and maturity as a musician. Just the more you do it, the easier it gets, right? And I think also, but of course, staying conscious while you're doing this. If you just keep playing the same stuff forever and you're happy with it, you're still going to sound the same. But if you keep maturing as a musician, then naturally these things will just be just better and better. For like Herbie Hancock, like, what's he doing now? Like, Good Night. I mean, and even back then, he's just such an excellent comping musician and soloist as well. But yeah, it's like, he's got it down. He doesn't, and he's got all the facility to do everything, and yet he doesn't play that until the musical moment, you know, calls for it. So now I wanted to talk about our related chords, stretching into our like more little complex talk here. So the first thing we got is this like a major mode, and there's tons of related chords, guys. Like, I mean, just absolutely unreal amounts of related chords, like we were talking about. But these are kind of fun ones, and more modern sounding chords. So let me see if I can snag on these real quick. I'm colorful for fun. So for the key of C major. Yeah, that's great. Like, we have D minor, 2 chord. So yeah, it's basically like what we were talking about earlier, like putting a chord with each note of the scale and what they're naturally going to be. C major is all the right keys, right? So we have Dorian being from D, right? B minor 7, flat 5, 7, which is also like a 13 chord from G13. And of course, 2, right? D minor. 5, G13, and then you have B minor 7 flat 5, and then this little bugger, like I called it earlier, F major 7 sharp 11, different way to voice it, which is, you know, amazing enough, like I said, it looks just like a G13 chord with an added 9. So yeah, that's our major in the key, you know, very boxed up, but by thinking, you know, like C major, seeing these options around it, we're like, okay, I've got C major here. I'm like, I could be like, do you double?
Yeah. Send me a message on Facebook.
So okay. I just created movement, you know, by,
I gotta go to work anyway.
I'll see you guys.
Bye. Sure. Just by thinking of another chord. got a vamp.
Yeah.
You know, I. So I think it was the initial point. So you're talking about comping in the key. Like you're just, this is like diatonic.
It's diatonic planning, basically. Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And then also, in a sense, a substitution and a choice for a darker or lighter sound, an open sound. Yeah, a very, you know, crunchy sound. You know, each chord's like, that's very dark, you know, this is very, you know, open and bright, and then you have like, kind of like stable, you know, and, you know, maybe pretty. You know, and so you know, figuring out these different sounds, but you can, you know, one, just create that movement, and two, you know, use them, like a, what is it? Everything you do in comping, you can do in soloing. So if you wanted to like, arpeggiate some kind of that major 7 sharp 11, slide down to a B minor 7 flat 5, and then slide up to a C major 7, you essentially just did that while I was playing C. You know, and slide it back in, you know. And so that's really, really a fun way to do it. Now this is just in C major, thinking of the two, because the one chord, the 6 chord, and the 3 chord, like we were talking about earlier, first inversion.
Those are all those triplets.
Yeah, they're basically the same thing. You know, I can, if somebody says C major, I'm more than welcome to play E minor 7 on it. I'm more than welcome to play A minor 7, assuming the root is there. And the voicing, I'm not defining it. If I'm at a solo gig, if I'm doing that, I have to watch myself. It can create awesome, or you know, if I'm playing with just you. You know, like you're like, oh my god, where is the form? He's like, keeps putting the third at the third of the bass at the top. Like, once is great, twice is all right, a third time, come on, where is the top? You know, like, you can really leave somebody hanging, and depending on, and like, you know, again, talking to them, does that bug you? Does it bug you if I don't put the root in the bass? And if they say no, I'm open season. You know, that's the key to that one. The next one is overthinking, you know, like, is kind of goosing it up, melodic minor, we're thinking of our, you know, our 5 chords, our more stronger pulling thing. So in C, again, it'd be a G7, sharp 9, sharp 5, D flat 9, sharp 11, and A flat major 7, or A flat minor with an added major 7. So these are, like, very similar sounds, A flat, major 7, A flat minor with a major 7. Like, it's so hard to say these things. And then E7, sharp 9, yeah, they're just very similar. You can get it.
Yeah.
You know, just very similar sounds, and with, like I said, without a root, again, you know, it's they're completely fine and can create movement. And even though they all contain all these like common tones and same notes and things like that, just the way that you order them and arrange them is gonna open up all these different options to people. And we haven't added a you know, much of an alteration or a substitution yet. You know, like we haven't done, you know, it's like we haven't even thought of a tritone sound.
Sure.
You know, it's, and so like there's just, it just gets, it's just so fun, you know. Isn't jazz fun? Like, for the rest of my life, I can continue playing something the same way. I think, except for F blues, I'm pretty sure I'm out of options. I don't know. I'm literally like, I gotta look at that again. Like, I think I've exhausted every way I can show up on that one. Maybe some more tritone subs that might work. So tritone subs and substitutions is kind of my next. Or no, it's not. Static versus functional dominant chords. That's what I wanted to talk about. So yeah, it's like when picking these chords, like, oh, well, we have major, minor, and dominant, you have to be really careful, because when there are like a functional dominant chord, it's like 5-1, 5-5-1, secondary dominance, anything where it's going somewhere, you can't pick like the sharp 11 voicings, and you know, all the time, because they have much more of a static sound to them, or picking the vanilla voicings like 13, 9, those aren't the preferred sound for that kind of movement. Now, that's not to say on the 12th pass that I shouldn't use it, like a game, grain of sand, but just to mix things up. Like, good night, how many times you hear the augmented chord going one there, just leave it a little plain, leave it, you know, get something for the listener, or if it's going 5-1, 5-1 so many times in a row, that can be, you know, give it some variety by using a substitution or using a different color there. But There's a Visc here on one of my... Sean has the funnest way of just writing me when Peter sheets of paper. I always love.
That's why I take a little bit.
Oh, yeah. I kind of like this. I did, and then I kind of liked it after a while. And I just popped in there. I'm like, yeah, he seems like he's comfy on this and like writes big. So functional, like the 5-1 or also a 7-1 in a sense is kind of another one, but it's less common and it's kind of a substitution for that. But for static, there's all kinds of options you can write down. Like if you want to have the list where it's like flat 2, flat 3, 4, flat 6, and flat 7 in like the key, those are going to be guaranteed static chords. You know, like second chord A train, or major 2 chord. And these are all major chords, by the way. Naturally, since they're dominant chords.
The dominant chords, you're talking about the major triad.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Not to say that they don't have a sharp 9 on top of it, a minor third.
Right. like the core of it, you maintain. But if we're not.
They'll have both sometimes too, yeah.
Alright. One of my questions later is about the altered chord of bass.
Oh yeah. Yeah, I mean what do you have about the altered chord?
Right now you're talking about dop, so yeah, I don't want to interrupt your flow
though. Oh no, there's no flow.
Seems like there's a lot.
There's so much.
Alright.
There is. It goes quick.
When you say dop, so we've talked about major quite a bit, which has been perfect.
Mm-hmm.
Now dominant, I feel like there's even more options,
mm-hmm.
because
that's
you're talking
right.
about diminished, augmented,
mm-hmm.
half diminished, like all these.
Not half diminished, it's an I would call minor chord.
Yeah. But then, then the altered scale itself.
Yeah.
So like, how are you coping with that in mind? And which one do you choose? Like you're talking about this functional harmony and the voice leading. And now we just got to dominant chords, and you're talking about the major triad a lot.
Oh yeah.
And if we're talking like an altered scale,
mm-hmm.
then
that was for static sounding dominant chords. That's a major triad more so than it is the in augmented chords. They don't look like they have an augmented triad, right? So it's like, and that's for functional use, usually going to about 5-1. The 5-1 sound seems like, you know, if I'm going to C major, I'm like a little rattle on there. Here's a strong 4 going to C minor, maybe. That is a much stronger pull versus going like a. It's not the right sound.
That's why we alter things for the voice lead.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And the, like, let's like for A train, you know, we're thinking, and we have the 2 there, major 2 chord, and that's the dominant static sound. It's
I guess I'm curious how you construct, because you've got all these choices,
mm-hmm.
how do you construct a voicing knowing that the bass is going to have the root, so then you've got all these altered chords
mm-hmm.
to choose from. Thinking like, starting on the flat 9, building a minor triad?
For this, I mean, there are a couple different stop voicings for us, are just like 7, 3, and that's a major 3, you know, and then we have a sharp 5, and then a sharp 9 on top. So yeah, throwing your upper extensions on top always is the best way to go about it. There are some flat 9, sharp 9 voicings below, but it starts to sound like kind of like a minor chord or a diminished chord. You know what I mean?
Okay.
The flat 9 and the sharp 9. So if you can put your upper extensions up on top, that helps to define that sound better. Another one, like 3-7, sharp 9. 7-3, sharp 5, sharp 9. Let's just skip the sharp 5 altogether. 5-5, forget it. You know, we got a sharp 9. We'll just be kind of... 3-7-9, 7-3, sharp 5-9, those are, you know, two.
So I think, just to clarify for me, I think what I hear you saying, Ethan, is that, this is at least the way I think about it from when I contemplate piano, and I tell me if this is the same way you guys kind of internalize it, is yes, there are all these options, there's limitless options,
mm-hmm.
seemingly.
Mm-hmm. But anything more unique, anything more, more unique, anything more, anything that's radically different, we're generally gonna take the time to figure out.
Yeah.
That's the way for me. So I mean, like I feel like when I'm in that situation where I just want to like playing through a lead sheet because I'm like learning a tune or something.
Yeah, I'm like,
I kind of have the sound the moment. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, you're stuck.
You got your stock ideas of like.
And my sight reading voices.
Yeah,
literally,
absolutely.
Like this will I can play everything with a two finger shake.
Yeah. So I mean,
classify. Yeah. It's not the best sound, but it'll sight read.
I mean, everyone's kind of always got their bag. At least for me, I've kind of got my idea. Like, okay, I can hammer out these like piano voicings. Mm-hmm. If I'm just kind of reading through a lead sheet. But then, you know, over time as you learn a tune, that's when you can really start to dig in hot and
yeah.
heavy, being like, because I think that the thing that's always that maybe doesn't get talked about enough is just like, it's like, yeah, there's like all these options, but it takes sometimes a while to figure out and work through, exhaust all those options.
Mm-hmm. And not all the options are good.
Yeah,
I wrote out 157 D7 sharp 11 chords one time on guitar, possible D7 sharp 11 chords.
Yeah.
And I circled 7.
Yeah.
That I like actually was like, that's not gonna hurt my hand. I can remember this. It's
yeah.
easy to see. And it's comfortable and it sounds good.
So I think that's why having some of those just like some of those calling cards that
mm-hmm.
everybody refers to is the good thing, because that way then you're not really having to think about like,
absolutely,
okay, I'm gonna start on this chord tone, and then you know that way there's too much information to process.
It's so really quick. It starts to blow up, you know,
right.
and like start to sound like a lot of numbers and a lot of notes and a lot of names.
So then in your guys' practice routine, talk about, you guys work actively on just practicing voicings and how you're creating those sounds so that then you can call on them.
I like to say it out loud too while I'm practicing,
sure.
to myself,
okay.
which is like really like annoying, but it's like, I'm like, no, it's kind of like, especially if I'm learning a new one, I'm like, A flat major 7, A flat major 7,
yeah.
A flat major 7,
yeah.
D flat major 7,
yeah.
D flat major 7 sharp 5, boom. And then just like, you know, and like quickly being able to, oh, what else is that? Oh, it's also this. if I want to use it for something else, you know. Otherwise, it's just there, you know.
Yeah.
And it really stinks. That's the boring part, but I mean, it's the fastest way I've learned how to do it. It's like literally just taking my hand off and saying it a few times and I'm done with it, versus like kind of like fiddling over here. I don't know. It's like if somebody asked me just like to like boom, 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 and then like grab a guitar and just do it, like I want to be able to do it without having to think about it. So that was the quick way for me to snag that one.
Yeah, and just for argument's sake, I can't do it that way. Like, unless I practice it in context,
uh-huh.
like if I'm working on a chord shape, I practice it in 2-5-1 like 25 times, and then I can know exactly where to go.
Yeah, I mean, and everyone's different too. Yeah, that's definitely for sure. Like what works for somebody does not work for someone else, and it's weird, you know.
Sure.
And comping chords are really hard in general, just because we're having to figure out a chord without a root half the time. And see it without the root, so you're seeing it from something else. Like, so if you don't really know your instrument that well, you're sort of shaking from the beginning. So it's good to get a handle on something before you move on to anything else. You know, that's the kicker. So yeah, these other things that passive static and functional. If you guys kind of got a grasp on that, or if you want to look at any of the take pictures of it, you're like more than welcome to. Like, go right ahead. Like, I'm not gonna sue you for it.
I'll make a copy after class.
Yeah, do it. Yeah, feel free. Voicing. You know, so voicings are just, you know, like, and all these I just kind of want to like scan over because we're running out of time as it is. And I knew I couldn't dig too much into any of them. So. You know, just voicings, like, you know, it's always important to just look into each instrument, like, as you're teaching them, like, okay, I've got a vibes player. Like, you know, go look up the vibes, the top vibes voicings, the standard ones that are going to work. And if you want to make something sound good with an ensemble, look for complementary voicings. Don't just, you know, guess around or let them fight for it. And, you know, but maybe, you know, still introducing, like, the ideas of, you know, broken chords and these extensions and substitutions. You can always kind of feed the fire just a little bit, you know, like maybe today I'll show them this one, but you know, you feed them this and this and this and then we're gone, you know, like there's no way I can get a handle on that. But you feed them one, feed them an extension, feed them a tritone substitution, feed him a first cousin, you know, like a triad there, thinking like you're talking about first cousins or similar sounds, you know, A major 7 and A major 7 sharp 5 are very close to the same chord, you know, even though they have drastically different sounds, you know, only one note changes it. So maybe, you know, having experimenting with that and how it works. And then, of course, like I talked about last time with the Freddie Green stuff, diatonic planing, like how we're doing earlier, diminished passing chords, swapping a diminished chord in between the scale in order to create extra movement, create harmonic, more rapid or movement, and this step, you know, in chromatic planing with the half step approach. And then that can be really fancy too, because it doesn't always just have to be from a half step. And that is like, and with all those, it's like rhythm comes into play. You have like, you know, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. So if you know, if you start early, you can actually approach from further away. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. Versus just 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. You know, and to give like variety, you know, in the most extended way, you could like look at the end of a chart and literally like start like 15 notes back and just like, that's legal. It's completely legal if you, as long as you end in the right spot, rhythmically accurate, it's gonna sound crazy. You know, you never know what happens in jazz. Nobody said it was easy, right? And tone of sensation, of course, putting a 5 in front of anything, or which in the 2 and the 5 can be put together. So if you want to make it a 2 and a 5, that's completely fine. Reharmonizations, you know, taking a tune and just finding different ways to harmonize it, and that there's no reason that can't be used in the moment and on a gig. You know, it's gonna happen. Like when I play with upper level musicians, it's like they're kicking my butt. They're changing things, and I don't know where they are. I've been lost. I will admit it. So yeah. Now moving out of that, moving into the final thing, it's like talking about just this generalizations according to historic subgenre, and like I said, very very general. You know, like New Orleans jazz, we have these like basic triads, chords, diminished augmented. And this is like usually at a medium, I think like harmonic rhythm, and sometimes up, but that's all just, it's very, very swing, standard, you know, swing air, has these standard stock voicings, but still uses diminished passing chords, and diatonic playing a lot was common. Bebop is where we start getting a little nasty, and most of you probably have heard the story of Monk talking about the minor 6 chord with the 6 in the bass, which creates our Yeah, so it's like that's where he found the sound. This is a minor 7 flat 5. Yeah. And they didn't call it that then. It was just a minor 6 chord. He's like, yeah, but I started putting the 6 in the bass. And so I got this minor 7 flat 5 chord. Like, again, an inversion. So he put the 6 in the bass. He's like, check that out. And then I can, like, move in the 2 chord like that. And it'd be awesome.
Awesome.
You know, like, yeah, Monk did that one. That was all Monk. So yeah, that's a bebop. We get the minor 7 flat 5 chord comes into play, and that's a really interesting chord, because like you were saying, it is a dominant chord in a sense. It can absolutely be used as a dominant chord, and the minor 6 chord is, like the one I just used, for instance, A minor 6 is also D9. Same thing, and it's also F sharp minor 7 flat 5. You know, it's like, and we can go on and on and on with other things it's close enough to, but it's exactly that, in an inversion minus like one note for the D9, you know. So it's very interesting. And then we get a lot more, altered chords start replacing diminished, is, you know, another key feature in bebop. We still have diminished, it's still popular, but it's starting to get replaced. Hard bop, I feel like, and cool sort of follow these same patterns as bebop did. We're not really like changing so much, except for like harmonic rhythm is just slowing down more than anything. But you know, giant steps is gonna use really stock voicings really fast and a new harmonic, new movement, you know, that nobody hasn't really done before. I was kind of talking with Mike about that for a while, just like, what if, because I tried to play with him the other night and I altered 80 chord, he added 9. An extension, and it was wrong. Like it just sounded so wrong. I was really surprised at like how wrong it sounded. It sounds great when I play boring major 7 into boring this, and even like D7, like it was like D7, like you for real, like just D7, not D9, not D13, like D7. And, but the way it was moving and the and thirds, and it makes it work that way, and it sounds really cool. Naturally, he's famous for it, right? Modern chords are cool. You know, it's like we're starting to get these kind of predetermined things, so it's hard to say like what the chords were, because a lot of that stuff was kind of written down beforehand, but then they have like, that's, I'm thinking of Mulligan, you know, if you're thinking of that, but like, of course, there's tons of cool artists that play completely improvised. I think I don't know that one. In the modal, we're getting these more common stacked fourth voicings, harmonized fourths, minor 11 chords, major 7, sharp 11, things like that, with the slow harmonic rhythm. And, you know, free jazz, get rid of it, polychords. For fusion, substitutions, alter harmony, things like that. Of course, all the other stuff can still apply. And then bossa nova just seems to be, to me, bossa and samba is just like a kind of a modern sound, but they bring back diminished. You know, like you can't play bossa nova without diminished chords. I don't care who you are. Like, you just can't. Like, I mean, they still do the whole, like, oh, let's replace that for an altered chord, but they use diminished for sure in there, and it's a significant part of the sound. Because I don't know if you guys, like, ever heard that, like, that's not sound. That's not a cool sound to play anymore. It sounds old. More people use like diminished too much. It's like better to settle for altered chords. And you know, it's like, oh, but I like diminished. But this is like kind of, it's very like obvious sound. Like when you hear diminished, you're like, well, there it is. You know, and I think that's probably had a lot to do with it.
Especially if it's stacked in third.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's where I think diminished sounds get old, is when, you know, because it's, you can still, you know, it's talking about stacking like dominant chords, like, well, I feel like with diminished chords, especially because of all of the minor third relationships within the chord itself, if you're stacking it just in thirds all the way up, that's when it gets really old. It's mm-hmm. like you have to finding unique ways to voice or to alter diminished chords is where they really are interesting, because mm-hmm. you're right, they do get old really fast. Mm-hmm. Because the sound is so recognizable, and it's so easy to gravitate to then when it's always like in that same sort of like
in between spot or yeah, like, you know,
and however, it's again stacked in thirds.
How do you approach altering a diminished chord?
It's sort of like a half whole scale, you know, when you say like it's like if it's like you know, you've seen like A7 flat 9, like all the diminished chords like B flat diminished. So they used to write B flat diminished.
Yeah.
And they started writing A7 flat 9 instead of
so it's how you relate it to like another dominant sound is basically how you think of like some sort of like diminished sound with an alteration. It's like how can relate by half steps to like dominant.
Right,
steps.
It's like the voice leading thing. But then you're talking about changing the root, so maybe that adds
so variety you can, to
can always like move a diminished note up a whole step, I believe it is. And get something else. There's only a couple for the car that sound better. Yeah, that's what it is. Yeah, moving up a whole step, and you can get different sounds like that, and add a note to it.
Yeah.
And so that's like one way to like enhance the diminished sound, but it's still like.
I mean, it's
still
not enough
diminished, you know.
It's not like technically like I would say like an altered sound per se, in the same way that you alter like a dominant chord. But how can you add to it? How can you
like colors it a little differently?
Yeah, how can you contextualize it differently, I guess, is what I should have said. That wasn't super clear.
It's hard. It's really hard to describe, I think, chords effectively and their sounds.
Sure.
Just in, like across the board, relatable. That was one of my issues in starting this. I was like, what do I call that? Mm-hmm. What do I actually? And it was tough to really decide the terms. So yeah.
Cool.
Thanks, man. Thank you guys for popping in. It makes it go a lot better to
copy this page.
Please do. Yeah, go for it. Paolo's like, oh man, you kept all that? I need to copy. He's like, oh good, I lost all my shit, man, from Sean. I need to copy all that. I was like, I'm not organizing the show.
Christ, you're